Good evening. Thank you, Ava ma'am, for this opportunity. There have been at least 60 publications in the last 2 or 3 years on Wilson's disease, but very few of them are actually in good in journals with high impact factor. So the first one looks at the long-term results of liver transplantation in Wilson's disease and experience from France. This is basically natural history. They've categorized 3 subgroups: fulminant, subfulminant hepatic failure, CLD, and neuro-Wilson's. 121 patients, 40% were children. Median post-transplant follow-up was 72 months. And obviously, the subfulminant and the fulminant group had higher MELD scores as compared to the others. So basically, majority of the patients were in the pediatric age group. So if you see, the fulminant hepatic group was the majority, the pediatric group, and 80% of them had hemolytic anemia. And the chelation prior to transplant was 18 days to 7 years in CLD. And the survival, especially with the fulminant hepatic group, was very high, 80 to 90%, as compared to the neurological Wilson's, which were about 50%. The patient survival, in terms of patient survival, the adults 90% and children 82%. Poorer survival was seen in males, those with pre-transplant renal issues and non-elective liver transplant, and those with neurological involvement. Now, having said this neurological involvement, I want to put some more fuel to the fire, and my apologies to the neurologists, but there is a case report, and I thought I should mention this case report, where there's a 19-year-old boy with neurological symptoms for the last 10 years, and he had increased copper load pre-transplant. 3 months post-transplant, everything reversed, patient improved. So the authors started to question as to, actually, can we say that neurological Wilson's do not require transplant? The other thing that they questioned is that they had an interesting observation in which they said that in the first month of transplant, there were more of anxiety issues and with tacrolimus and cyclosporin with worsening of mood. When they replaced with everolimus and mycophenolate, the patients responded. So now, what is the best regimen in such a scenario, they had questioned. This is a very interesting article, The Long-Term Metabolic Correction for Wilson's Disease in a Murine Model by Gene Therapy. Adenoviral vector that has ATP7B human DNA. You have the control mice, you have the Wilson's disease mice, where the knocked out gene is there, and then you have these knocked out gene with the adenovirus incorporated. And these mice were studied at 4, 9, 14, and 24 weeks. The response was remarkable. Those mice in which this adenoviral vector was given, there was improvement in the ceruloplasmin, the ALT levels, the urinary copper excretion. The hepatic copper also content decreased, the hepatic ATP7B expression increased, and the liver injury decreased. Then they instilled intraperitoneal 100 grams of copper sulfate into the abdomen, and they saw that everything reverses. So the ATP7B mice who had this, their excretion of urinary copper and fecal copper were comparable to the controls. So conclusion was that adenoviral vector mediated gene therapy provides long-term correction of copper metabolism. This is the apheresis study from America. This is their registry. 10 critically ill Wilson disease patients, age 17 years, who are very sick, not able to take up for transplant. 43 total plasma exchange procedures. Median session over 1 to 13 days. First TP to liver transplant was 14 days. 9 of these patients with transplanted liver survived, and 1 with a native liver survived. This is an oral presentation at EASL, so only the abstract is available. This is tetrathiomolybdate. 6 patients, 18 to 53 years, were given 60 mg of tetrathiomolybdate. At 8 to 36 weeks, there was improvement in every score, NASA score, neurological score, decoppering, everything. This is a study from our institute. They looked at oxidative stress. So we know that free copper is very toxic. It reduces the antioxidant levels and increases the oxidative stress. So now 29 patients of neurological and 9 asymptomatic patients, they could show low glutathione, low total antioxidant capacity, high lipid peroxidation and high glutamate. Thereafterwards, they showed there was also high cytokine activity in the neurological Wilson's group. Then they found that there was good correlation with the glutamate levels, with the TNF-alpha. So here is the TNF-alpha, the ceruloplasmin, the urinary copper, and the lipid peroxidation levels. Similarly, they could show total antioxidant capacity. The good correlation was there with the duration of the disease, serum copper, urinary copper, and ceruloplasmin. And finally, they concluded that free copper is definitely associated with oxidative stress. In the next part of the study, they looked at the role of oxidative stress in those patients who neurologically worsened. So 51 of these patients were put on chelation. They're prospectively evaluated, followed them up at 1, 3, and 6 months with neurological worsening. 28% of those on DPEN deteriorated over 8 to 24 weeks. And here also they could show with the free serum copper levels, the glutathione levels came down, the total antioxidant levels came down, and the lipid peroxidation went high, as you can see here, both at 3 months and at 6 months. And finally, they concluded that increase in the serum copper is also associated with the oxidative stress, leading to neurological worsening. Now, here is a concept, a novel concept of exchangeable copper. This is an evolving concept. So what we know is that non-ceruloplasmin-bound copper usually has fallacies. There are negative values occasionally. Pitfalls are there in the measurement of ceruloplasmin, so it's not a true reflection of the toxic amounts of copper in our body. So 2009, somebody came up with the concept of exchangeable copper. This exchangeable copper is basically a labile fraction of copper that is complex with the albumin, and it is easily exchanged in the presence of EDTA. So what happens is they take serum, they take EDTA, they incubate it under normal saline condition, and then by ultrafiltration process method, they look at this exchangeable copper level. So this is a study where they looked at the exchangeable copper levels. This was the hepatic group, this was the extrahepatic group that contained the Wilson's disease, and they found that of all the predictors of toxic levels of copper, the exchangeable copper levels were probably the best predictor. So here, the exchangeable copper levels correlated well with the unified Wilson's disease rating score, the Kayser-Fescher ring, and the brain MRI score, but not good relations with the liver functions. So copper levels more than 2, indicative of the severity of extrahepatic involvement, and the researchers also said that in case of purely hepatic presentation, where you do not have neurological signs, look at this. Probably this is an indicator of the extrahepatic copper load. This is a prospective evaluation of the hepatic copper content that we were discussing in the morning. So I'll just show you the gist of this. I won't go into the detail because it's too long, the paper. But what they had found was out of 690 patients, 178 patients with Wilson's disease, who had this amount of dry weight of copper. Now the dry weight of copper, as it was discussed in the morning, the dry weight of copper, they had taken two passes, 1 milligram piece of copper, they put it at 68 degrees, dried it for 2 hours, put it under atomic absorption spectrophotometry, obviously they had a copper lamp for that, and then they could detect the amount of copper that was there. And then they found that it's not the 250 micrograms per kg per gram dry weight that has best sensitivity, but actually 209 grams per dry weight. And that had a sensitivity of specificity of 99 and 96. So what they are advising is bring down the level of 250, cut off to 209 if you want to have hepatic copper estimation. So these are the studies I had. And here are just the details of the same. This is the ROC curve that showed. That's it. Thank you.
Just start the question. Okay, so just to start the question, we need to have some questions on these very important papers that Moinak has now.
So I've shown gene therapy, apheresis, tetrathiamine, molybdate.
My first question, I'll set the ball rolling. My first question to you is that you showed this exchangeable copper.
Yes.
And you said that they concluded that it doesn't seem to be having a good correlation with the hepatic, thing. And how do you explain that? And what is the explanation that they have?
They have not given an explanation for the same. What they are saying is that this exchangeable copper, the hepatic copper, the amount of hepatic toxicity that we have, I'm sorry, can I go back to the slides? Yeah. The amount of hepatic toxicity that we have, we cannot predict with the same. But the exchangeable copper that is there in the brain, the eyes, and probably other areas is the true reflection by the exchangeable copper method. They are not able to say exactly why the hepatic copper had no correlation, but that is just their observation. The very concept of exchangeable copper is a new thing. It is just evolving. And this is only one such paper which has come in an impact factor of 3.9. The earlier ones that came did not actually make it to higher impact.
No, well, how are they measuring the exchangeable copper?
So it is by the ultrafiltration process, ma'am, I had said.
Okay.
This is not by the routine, let's say ceruloplasmin is done by the nephelometric method or anything like that. It's not by that. It is by the ultrafiltration process that they are doing.
So where are they actually measuring it? And
this
what
is the blood.
In the blood?
Yeah.
Okay.
It is the blood. They mix it with the EDTA and they incubate it in certain temperature in normal saline. And there afterwards, they look at two sort of measurements. I was not clear from the, this was actually the toxicologist's
so
paper.
This doesn't reflect the serum or the free copper that we talk about when
no,
we talk about
no,
the...
No. They are saying this is a exchangeable copper. Wherever it is free, it will exchange with the EDTA and then you will see that rise.
Okay. So you don't feel there's any applied part to this exchangeable copper. What is the...
The applied part is for probably the neurologists and those who are seeing the other side of Wilson's disease. For us, probably not yet we have much of proof.
Okay. Do you have any questions? Okay.
What were the indications for the Wilson's disease liver transplantation?
Okay.
Two-thirds were acute liver failure.
Yes.
Can you go back?
This is a very nice paper.
Uh-huh.
So this, if you see the definitions, they've done a very nice definition. They looked at three groups, fulminant, subfulminant. Liver failure, less than 2 weeks of symptoms. Who were asymptomatic earlier were fulminant. Subfulminant, the same thing, but 2 to 12 weeks of symptoms. CLD were those patients who were unresponsive to medical therapy and probably had neurological, some of them had neurological involvement and some did not. And then the last one was the neurowilsons without history of any liver failure or liver involvement.
And what was the outcome in each group?
Yeah, the outcome was this. Mm-hmm. The survival was in the chronic liver disease and the fulminant hepatic group was 80 to 90%, but the neurological group was 50%. And most of these liver failures occurred in the younger age groups and 80% had a hemolytic anemia associated with this. So they had all received chelation prior to that, but they failed the chelation obviously, leading to failure.
You know, it's important in subacute liver failure because the time when they require a transplant can vary anywhere from few weeks to sometimes 3 months, sometimes 4 months, subacute. So it's important that we institute these patients on D-penicillamine. Again, they are geographical variability. Abstract presented at ASLD, they took about 92 liver transplant doctors, asked them how many of them received D-penicillamine in acute liver failure, okay, acute liver, according to their definition. And they found that almost 90% of Europeans give them D-penicillamine, whereas only 10% of Americans give D-penicillamine. So again, there are geographical way in which you practice medicine. But if there is a patient who has what looks like subacute or subfulminant liver failure, there are enough number of reports to say that not all, but a small fraction at least, you can help them and wean them away from transplantation.
You mean but the chelators, not just
D-penicillamine.
Even triantrin.
In the US, they use triantine more often than D-penicillamine.
Yeah.
In America, in Europe, they use penicillamine as well as triantine.
I'd like to ask the question. If it is early hepatic encephalopathy or maybe covert, would you advise chelators or not? Like in fulminant Wilson's failure with grade 1 encephalopathy.
Yeah, I know there are anecdotal reports. And all these reports that you hear, and when I wrote the paper, we reviewed this extensively. Whenever you hear that patients with on chelators improve, you'll almost always find that they are grade 1 encephalopathy.
Mm.
And even grade 1, as we discussed, is quite iffy.
Yeah.
Grade 1, grade 2 is always iffy. But the moment you have grade 3 encephalopathy, you will hardly ever find a patient recovering from encephalopathy. They almost always either die or they require a liver transplantation.
Thank you.
To you only, Harshad. You said the grade 1 hepatic encephalopathy?
Yeah, hepatic encephalopathy.
Are you sure?
Yeah, Because in the
we are talking of the cognitive dysfunction, cognitive impairment. Even in the chronic hepatitis C, you get the cognitive impairment. You can say it is MHE, minimal hepatic encephalopathy. The moment you treat the chronic hepatitis, because you know the Hep C have the central effect also, CNS effect also.
That is why I'm saying that patients...
So that's what I'm asking you. Are you sure that it is because of the liver failure or it is just because of the cognitive dysfunctions because of the Wilson's disease? Because the Wilson's disease does not only affect the liver but also the neural also.
Yeah, but you know, I think we can discuss this. Okay. But when I say grade 1 encephalopathy, the authors followed the West Haven criteria. Now, whether the grade 1 was because of purely liver-related, non-related, I mean, that's debatable.
And here we are talking of largely the studies done in children where hepatic encephalopathy is present is usually in the hepatic presentation, not neurological.
No, there is something called Wilsonian encephalopathy. Maybe the neurologists sometimes talk about it, where they don't have significant liver disease, where you wouldn't expect encephalopathy, but they have predominantly neurological Wilson's and they have encephalopathy. This has been referred to in some papers.
I'm not sure, other than in hepatic disease, whether we use the term as encephalopathy in Wilson's disease. Predominantly neuropsychiatric form of Wilson's disease, when you do bedside assessment, casually you ask them whether you forget, whether how is your memory, they say they're fine. But when you do some kind of neuropsychological battery, then you will find some frontal lobe defects in them. I'm not sure where anybody uses really in terms of, in pure Wilson's term, encephalopathy.
I just want to make a quick mention that sometimes we do think that children have gone into grade 1 encephalopathy. But once you correct the hypoalbuminemia within a day or two, you realize that maybe the slight decrease in irritability or dullness was more related to hypoalbuminemia. That's one. The other thing is we've had one or two children who have had an upper GI bleed going in for a nice profound encephalopathy post upper GI bleed. Once you correct them, I think they recover.
Yeah, ammonia is usually associated.
You know, I like Dr. Anil Dhawan's statement that all children in the hospital are in grade 1 encephalopathy.
I wonder whether we should call it Wilsonian encephalopathy. Other thing could be a patient could be in severe dystonic storm. So that may, if you call it a Wilsonian encephalopathy, but nobody...
Look at literature.
Yes.
There is a storm
okay. Yes. That must have been, because I've never read this term.
Okay, just a quick question, either to Monak. In the olden days, when you did the early Sternlieb and Scheilberg experiment, when they looked at hepatic copper repeatedly biopsied after treatment with penicillamine, they showed that even after 5 or 7 or 8 years, hepatic copper was still very high. Has there been any recent literature which has serially done hepatic copper to really know, does the hepatic, when does hepatic copper come back to normal? Because I have not seen recent data. The old data says even 8 years, 9 years down the line, your hepatic copper still remains very high. All other copper may go down, but not the hepatic
actually,
copper.
Actually,
is that still true?
No, I actually, for this particular presentation, I put a PubMed search exactly for liver copper and tried to see what are the latest articles on the same. There are, sir, a lot of articles which you would not like to believe. Mm-hmm. But of the ones which are of good impact factor, this is the only one I could find. Of the recent last 3 years, which has looked at liver copper in a, you know,
this Chinese study. Yeah. This is Chinese study,
exactly.
I can't remember the exact year, but Walsh had done a study like that to look at, because previously the only way to diagnose Wilson was to do hepatic liver estimation, and so over the period that they realized, doing urinary copper estimation was excellent tool, and they also trying to see the copper balance versus some of the tests. And in that article, at the end, they also mentioned, so probably you don't have to do liver biopsy anymore to diagnose or treat these patients. So I don't think that questions becomes now, you don't have required this question anymore to see whether you want to see the liver copper. You want to see the patient, actually. If the patient is doing fine, that should be a good indicator.
Actually, the earlier studies that came, they wanted to probably define an endpoint.
Yes.
In search of an endpoint, they wanted to see when can we actually stop and say, okay, this amount of chelation has been done, we can switch over to zinc or something.
Actually, the relationship with
Possibly. Okay, we'll end it at this point. That one question that is there in my mind, which we have not discussed, is the fact, do we ever stop the drugs or not? Mm-hmm.